recently. Let's move to our other big debate tonight. The chilling confession of the two men who are charged with raping a young girl says that they watched porn and then went out and did this horrific act. They were also drunk. Increasingly, police officials are warning of links between watching porn and violent sexual crimes. They say it is now so easily available that you can get a mobile loaded with pornographic content for just around 150 rupees extra. But is it about content or the sick minds who carry out such brutal crimes and poor policing? Currently in India, distributing porn is banned. But look at the reality in Delhi.
The sale and transmission of pornography is a violation under Indian law, but it's becoming very prevalent. In fact, those who don't have access to the internet need look no further than the local neighborhood cell phone recharge point, where very often just for 30 or 40 rupees,
we try several shops in Delhi's Sadar Bazaar area. We start by going to a shop which sells cell phone talk time recharge coupons and accessories. Here we are told that for just 40 rupees and in 5 minutes, the customer can select more than 2 hours of pornographic content. The shop owner then proceeds to show us the files loaded on his laptop. The shop owner even shows us a cell phone that he has just loaded for another customer. We go to another shop. This one too sells cell phone talk time recharge coupons and also a little extra. We ask if he has phone memory chips preloaded with porn. Police officials admit that they are worried, especially in light of the latest rape in the capital of a 5-year-old by two men. Both the accused were allegedly drunk and had been watching porn on their mobile phone before luring the child into a basement and raping her. Ironically, under the Information Technology Act, selling and transmitting porn can attract a jail term of 5 years and a fine of 10 lakh rupees. But that seems to have done little to deter those involved in this growing market. With camera person Gopal Singh and Amitesh Mahajan, in New Delhi, Siddharth Pandey for NDTV.
So already distributing porn illegal, but look at how easily available it is in Delhi. However, there are many, many different views on this. Currently, a PIL is on in the Supreme Court, but the Minister of State for IT said that they haven't made up their mind. They must consult experts first. Well, some of the experts on this panel tonight, I've got two senior police officers with me. Himanshu Roy, who is the Chief of the Crime Branch of Mumbai Police. Also, Tejinder Luthra, Joint Commissioner of Police, Delhi. I'm also joined by Ranjana Kumari, who is the Director, Centre for Social Research. Kiran Kher, member of the BJP National Executive, also well-known actress. Khushbu, also well-known activist, politician and actress. Thank you all very much for joining me. Himanshu Roy, across to you first. Is this just, when we look at how easily porn is available, we reported from a Delhi market, but I'm sure it's the same in Mumbai, many other cities and small towns. Do you actually see a link, or really is this just part of the changing world around us? It's not about the content, but it's about the sick minds who carry out these crimes.
Sonia, there is a reliable association between pornography and deviant sexual behavior. Sexual offenders, in my experience, have pornography as an associated behavioral pattern. There appears to be a pre-existing pathology and a deviant arousal which gets attracted to certain images which others might well be revulsed by. Obviously, it would be overstating the case to suggest that mere exposure to pornography makes one commit a sexual crime. But in those people who are so pre-inclined, sexual offenders, watching pornography and exposure to pornography certainly fuels the intention to commit the crime, and they go ahead and commit it.
So it acts as a trigger in a sense, is your point, Mr. Roy. But Tejinder Luthra, why is it then, when we talk about the fact that distribution is illegal, why is it when we see it so easily available, when we talk about policing, these really are the issues that we look at as well, that the law currently outlaws it, yet it's available for 40 rupees in this market?
You know, I must start with the fact that I don't agree with Himanshu Roy. Pornography may arouse one's sexual sense, but sexual sense is different, and intention to commit crime and physically committing that crime, particularly a sex crime, is completely different. And let me also tell you, there is no fine line. Rather, if you ask me, there is a broad, huge line between one's sexual sense and the intention and physical act to commit a sex crime.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, I would not like to link the two unless there is a credible study, there is some empirical evidence and analysis available to us.
Mm-hmm.
In this scenario, when you have raised this question, I appreciate your concern about linkages between pornography and sexual crimes. Therefore, we must urge our social scientists to conduct a Desi India-specific credible study and let us know if there is any linkage between the two. Having said that, I must answer your question. Of course, pornography is a crime as per Indian Penal Code as well as the Information Technology Act. But of late, even the kind of crime you showed us, it only shows us the last milestone of the crime.
Mm-hmm.
The agent is selling you a kind of coupon or a card, but the connectivity is somewhere else. The servers are abroad. Therefore, pornography has left the brick and mortar state of affairs. It has gone online and servers are abroad. Therefore, increasingly, it is becoming difficult for us to crack this kind, particularly this kind of online pornography.
No, and also the point is that with porn mobiles, it's also left, say, bedrooms or access to computers, because now you get it in your mobile phone. Kiran Kher, you wanted to come in on that point about the easy availability of it. Tejinder Dutha points out the difficulty of actually cracking down this online world. It's virtually impossible to crack down on online pornography. Viewing pornography is not a crime, but distribution, which is what we are seeing happen, is. What is your perspective on that?
Sonia, first I'd like to say that I do not agree with Dr. Tejinder when he says that pornography has no direct link to deviant sexual behavior. I agree with Mr. Himanshu Roy. This is a country of large divides. You have uneducated people who have had no contact with girls of their own age, who are brought up in a repressed society. They're completely uneducated, and available to them are all this pornographic material. What happens? I mean, as you say, it arouses their sexuality, and they, if they see deviant material, they do it in a deviant way. They can't get older women, they go across and pick up children and do it. Why are crimes against little girls and little boys increasing so much in the last years? Because of this pornography being easily available. And if you can't keep the pornography away from these people away from the pornography, you have to keep the pornography away from them. It has to be banned. This country can't afford to wait for a study to find out how it is affecting people, because by then so many other rapes would have happened.
No,
and another thing you said,
yes,
about the easy availability, they have never been able to do, the police has been able to do nothing about piracy of films. How do you expect them to do anything about this? Most times the beat constables are hand in glove with these people. It's a nexus between the underworld mafia that supplies all this films and pornography and various other things which are not licensed, and the person who's on the beat. Everybody's on the take. That's why it doesn't work. You need very strong policing for this.
In fact, I'm going to come back to that point of policing, but Ranjana Kumari, if you can come in here. Often the point is that when we look at sex crimes, the demand is hang the rapist as if the crime ends there, or somebody should resign and the rapes will end. Though that may be an issue of accountability, may be a valid argument, do we not look enough at the what are the various factors that contribute to the increasing number of violent sexual crimes? Again, police officials I've talked to, and even Mr. Himanshu etc., made the point earlier that this is not so much about lust or sexuality, it's also about brutalization, the brutal way that children are being targeted, the brutal way that sexual crimes are being carried out. In your experience, as somebody who's worked in this area for years, what would you say?
Well, Sonia, first of all, I think it's pornography is all about, as long as gender inequality exists, as long as it's all about sexual, the unequal sex relation and power relations in society, because women and children are vulnerable, they are under the control, they can be subjugated, they can be made to do whatever they want to do, they are asked to do and made to do. So pornography really uses that kind of power relations and vulnerability of children and women. At the same time, it is of course all kinds of coercion, violence, subjugation of women. It is sex slavery, it is sex sexual abuse. So I think anybody, and let me just correct Mr. Luthra, because he's one of the senior officers of police, and I think when he talks about research, he should look around a little bit these days. And coming from an academic background myself, I can just inform him that there are researches in America, in Australia, in England, where conclusively very serious senior journals have printed these studies, where conclusively in one study where convicts who were under a rehabilitation program, 85% of the child abusers, molesters, rapists accepted the fact that they had gone through child pornography. And let me just read out one, because I really want the nation to be a little more informed, and such senior officers talking about it in such irresponsible manner is not acceptable. Pornography has corrosive effect. An individual becomes increasingly interested in child pornography, is attracted to images of increasing severity, and becomes desensitized to the harm victim experiences. Use of pornography in the long term may also increase the risk that the person will sexually abuse a child. And these are the conclusions of very, very serious research which has tried to see if there is any kind of link between pornography.
I'm not an academic, but I know that there have been studies also that have linked that in America, of course, porn is much more easily available now than it was 20 years ago. But the violence, there's been a corresponding drop in sexual crimes as well in America, if you take it as an example. But I just want to...
I think those are sponsored perhaps by this $1 trillion industry. Those are sponsored by... Because child pornography is also sex slavery. It's banned across the globe.
Child pornography is not allowed
anywhere in the world.
I don't think we're talking specifically of child pornography.
We are marketing it. Look at the way we are trying to say there is no link between...
I think your point is right. The child pornography, of course, is completely illegal. Okay. But Tejinder Luthra, do you want to react quickly to what Ms. Ranjana Kumari said before I go across to Khushbu? Go ahead.
Of course. I think Ms. Ranjana Kumari, with due respect to you, you missed my point.
No, I can tell him I've accessed at least 10 researches.
Let me say something. I think you missed my point. I said we do not have any India-specific study, number one. Of course, you quoted an America-specific study.
Well,
I do respect your views, but even in your study, when you quoted, you use the word
America, Austria, Germany, England.
Let me complete. Please don't interrupt me. I never interrupted you when you said many things about me.
Okay.
You use the word may. It may increase. The conclusion is not yet conclusive. Even the study you are quoting. So please go again about your studies that you just read.
Khushbu, let me just bring you in here, because
one interesting aspect to be watched
closely in the European Union is the extremely liberal country of Iceland is actually considering, its parliament is considering a proposal to actually ban pornography as well. So it's not about necessarily being conservative or being repressive when you say ban porn. This is not about freedom of expression, but it's about larger issues. And as you said, Iceland, extremely progressive, is looking at a proposal to ban porn. Do you think we need to take the whole issue of porn away from the freedom of expression debate? Or do you think this is a conservative approach? We are avoiding the real issue when we look at porn as an excuse.
Sonia, I don't think taking away porn, banning the porn is going to help anything. A mindset of a man is what has to change. And what happened with these two men agreeing that they were watching porn and they were drunk when they raped this 5-year-old kid. We are stressing on the point that they have been watching porn. They have agreed to it. But why are we missing out a point saying that these two people have also been drinking? Mm-hmm. They were drunk. So if pornography can lead, if watching pornography can trigger a mindset, I think even drinking, even alcohol can lead to it. So if you're banning pornography, ban alcohol altogether. Why are we not even thinking of that point? We have so many brutality against women which has been happening in our country, and most of the time, this is the first time the people have said that yes, we have been watching pornography before committing a crime. But most of the brutality, whether it is brutality at home, whether it is violence against women or whatever it may be, I think most of the cases what we have studied and we have looked into it and we have come across has been that people have been under the influence of alcohol. So why we have never debated on saying that let's ban alcohol for altogether? Why don't we think on that point? Banning porn is not going to help anybody.
Himanshu,
we have already seen it.
Kiran Khair, you wanted to react. Go ahead.
I wanted to say that I agree that there should be a mindset change. But that mindset change is going to take many, many years, because there are generations of uneducated, illiterate, crazy people which have come because of the kind of large divide between the rich and the poor, and you know, just been ignored for years, and all these khap panchayats and all these people getting killed because of love marriages. How many years is that going to take? Let's make a start somewhere. This mindset can't afford to see pornography. A mindset that is developed, a mindset that is more inclined towards liberal thought, possibly can take pornography in an erotica, in the way of erotica, the way it should be. But we can't take that risk within India, where 70% of people don't belong to that educated mindset.
But Kiran, is that a politically incorrect argument to make? That's a politically incorrect argument to make. People will say, look, it's easy to blame migrants. What about the educated class who carry out rapes? Ranjana, you wanted to react. Go ahead.
Yes, I just wanted to give you another information, Sonia, and also I think through you to everybody else, that there are very careful researches which have proved direct link between pedophilia and child pornography. You know, because the more they see it, the more they become coercive, the more they become abusive to the children, the more they become... You see, in these cases, these were rape and also inserting foreign object in the vagina of the little child. So I think these are the kind of ideas that are coming through this marketing of aggressive marketing at the moment is happening. You pick up your phone middle of the night, somebody is calling you, and all kinds of things starts, you know, coming to your ear, all kinds of sounds and noise, and you do not know what kind. And imagine a young man who has come from a village where, and look at the society, right. It is completely segregated in terms of you know, two sexes. Look at the way our preparedness to receive this kind of a sleaze which have been almost dumped on us in the way.
Let
that
me just get Himanshu Roy onto that, because Himanshu Roy, I remember interviewing you some months
who are
ago
rich, when, who are educated,
when that
choose,
horrific case, I think again, as some television
choose.
Producer who had been murdered, chopped up into pieces, and we had talked then of the increasing brutality of crimes that you as chief of the crime branch are seeing every day. And you've talked about also people coming, not necessarily poor, so I don't think we should blame this on workers, but even people from a middle class background coming to a big city, unable to deal with the influences that are around them. Do you think that's a valid factor? Are we, as Khushbu is pointing out, missing the point? She says, look, then ban alcohol. How far back are we going to go when we look at this? The world is changing. We have to live within this world.
Sonia, I would also like to bring in a point that the rape is not committed by illiterate
Sonia,
and uneducated people alone.
Yeah, I'm just going to come to that, but I just want to get Manjul Roy's views first. Go ahead, Mr. Roy.
Yeah.
Sonia, I lay no claims to being a scholar, but I can tell you in my 25 years of policing, I have repeatedly seen that those who commit sexual offences have indulged in pornography, exposure to pornography prior to committing the act. And that exposure fuels their sexual fantasies and their deviant behavior. About that connection, I have little doubt, and I think as senior police officers, we should not be defensive about this. This is a fact. And I don't know about research papers, but my 25 years of policing experience tells me this. Now, whether pornography should be banned or it shouldn't be banned, well, I think that's really a very, very large debate, and I think it needs a consensus at a very high level to take a call on that. But there is no doubt that we must identify sexual deviants in our society. And at least those who are sexually deviant, those who are pre-inclined to commit these kind of crime, they should not be allowed any kind of exposure to sexually explicit material. Otherwise, what we are doing is we are creating a critical mass. We are putting together a time bomb and we are lighting it, and it's going to go off one day.
But you know, Mr. Murray, you're not answering the question that Kiran Khair made the point. She said this is also about policing. Why is it that this is so easily available? Forget banning porn or viewing porn. There's actually a ban on distribution of porn. Why is it so easy available? Why do you get porn mobiles? Why do you get it downloaded at 40 rupees extra or something like that, where it is so easily available? I mean, it's cheaper than buying a book. For instance, what is the police doing about that? Isn't there a nexus to the beat constable? There has to be a nexus for this to flourish openly.
That is precisely the point I was trying to make, that first we must identify the problem as a society, and also as police leaders, we need to identify that this is an issue which needs a top priority. Unfortunately, this issue has never been prioritized. It is an offense. Selling pornography is an offense. Circulating pornography is an offense. We as a society, we as the police force must decide that it's time to crack down on this, like, and come down like a ton of bricks on it and clean our streets. I don't know about other cities, but I can tell you, Sonia, you can try and send your reporters to Mumbai, and it won't be so easy to find pornography here as you have shown in other cities.
Tejinder Luthra? I mean, I have to tell you, those people were selling this publicly. We blurred their faces, but they had no issues with coming on camera because they didn't even realize, I think, that this was illegal.
I must make a very important point here. I think I should have made it in the beginning that in this particular case, I mean, this case has become the context of this debate. So far, we have searched and seen the mobile of these accused. We haven't found any pornography on that. We have seized a television and a video player and some video CDs, which we have seized and we have sent to the forensic science laboratory. The result is yet to come whether there was some pornographic material on those CDs or not. And there is no confession in the police file made by these two accused that they had seen pornography before they did it. Therefore, we must set the context right also, of course. There is a larger context, but if at all we are talking about this
specific... Didn't the police commissioner say it in his press conference? Because that was a public, this was a public fact as far as I know of that they were watching porn. But again, not that that's necessary.
I don't know what he's talking about and what police commissioner said.
But again, I mean...
What Mr. Luthra is talking about or what we were told through the media.
No.
So I think there has to be some kind of a seriousness in responding to such a serious issue where the whole nation is worried. That, you know, there, and we know that there are cases where we know that, you know, you cannot say that what police commissioner told the people that there was this pornography which was watched by these people, and here is a senior officer saying that no. So anyway, that's besides the point. The point is that, you know, a kind of pornography is something which is really creating the kind of mindset among the young people who are sociologically, socially, culturally and psychologically not prepared to receive the kind of material which has been bombarded, and then there has to be a deviant behavior because that kind of a link.
No, but I think again the point by the, which Mr. Luthra was asking on the point of policing, because why is it that it's so easily available on Delhi street? Forget, as I said, it's currently illegal.
Yes. You know, I must assure you that pornography is our top agenda. Cracking pornography is our top agenda, and we are doing a lot to crack this menace. But still, there are some places where you can find it. It is difficult to stop.
This is Palika Bazaar in Delhi. It's the main one, bazaars in Delhi.
And the way they sell it is they do not sell it in open. There are, I mean, you have to really search for the vendor, and the vendor will take you some nook and corner of the market, and there he will sell you in a stealthy way. So it is not being sold openly, because we have cracked our whip on this menace, and I must assure you that we are leaving no stone unturned to stop this crime.
Let me just get in, Khushbu. I mean, Mr. Luthra, as I said, well, something. Hopefully our reporter can take you and show you where he got these porn. Wait, Kiran, I want to come at Khushbu. Because I think, Khushbu, you make an important point which has got lost. The point you're making on, is it entirely true to say, look, this is about a cultural issue. These are people who come from small towns or villages. These are people who are poor. Is that entirely true? Because also what Mr. Manshu Roy said, you can look at it the other way around, that perhaps it's people who are sexually deviant who are watching porn and then carrying out these crimes. It's part of that same sexual deviance. So lots of people who watch porn and don't carry out crimes. So it's not entirely interlinked. But go ahead in this point, because we know that when the politicians often try to blame it, the Chief Minister of Delhi said, look, the migrants from UP and Bihar are doing this. Raj Thackeray says the people from Bihar are doing this. Do you think it's a dangerous path to go down?
I don't think so. We have been getting all these reports that it's not only the uneducated people who have been living in the rural areas who have been committing this crime. We have seen a lot of educated people under the influence of alcohol also committing these kind of crimes. We have seen marital rapes, we have seen basic rapes, acid attacks, every brutality you name it against women, and we have seen in most of them also have a very, very well educated people committing these crimes. So you cannot
put it into an order and say that, okay, so and so person has been committed by the people living in rural areas and so person by the people living in the urban areas. I think curtailing the pornography is a point, but what I'm saying is we have the laws. We have very stringent laws which says that you have a fine of 10 lakh rupees, yet people continue to do that. All I would like to ask Mr. Luthra is, you know it's somewhere in Palika Bazaar, you know there is a special vendor, you know he takes it to the corner of the entire market, and how stealthily they do this process of downloading it on your mobile or your iPad. You know everything, sir, so why nothing has been done about it? I mean, you know how it is done, so what else does a cop need? You know how it's done, you know how they carry it forward, how these vendors work, so why we are just talking about it? Why are we not curtailing it? Yes, but the more you try to curtail it, the more you try to say that this should not be there, it's going to bring the curiosity point where they say we still want to see it. Whatever said and done, it's there at the point of your finger. Any computer, even at home, whatever you do, your iPads, your mobiles, even without downloading
it, I think Mr. Luthra was making a point how to crack down on it, because it's not brick and mortar, it's also about internet servers. I think he did answer that point, but Kiran Kher, you wanted to come in on that.
No, I wanted to say firstly that when Mr. Himanshu Roy says that we have to be very careful to find out who are the people who are with a deviant nature and keep them away from this, how is it possible in a country or in a locality or anywhere? How do you know what's going on in somebody's, the dark recesses of somebody's mind? So you have to keep this pornography away from everybody. You cannot, at least it's one step. I mean, okay, there's a large populace out there. There are people with crazy ideas. There are people in all kinds of strata of society who are doing this. But we have to start somewhere. And it is a fact that it is the migrants who've been coming in the latest cases. They've all been found from small villages.
I have to contest that point, because I don't think that's entirely true. Maybe in this case, but I don't think it's only about that. Ranjana Kumari.
Also in the previous case, also in the Nirbhaya case.
I think that's a very, no, Ranjana, I'm not saying any one state.
I mean migrant workers who are illiterate, who have not had contact with girls on a day-to-day basis, who come from backgrounds that are very poor.
I don't think you can blame
them
on migrant workers. I mean, I don't think you can at all. You've seen rapes happen in schools. You've seen minors targeted. You've seen cousins targeted.
We deal with a lot of domestic violence cases. We have women.
Of course, India is very good at that. I know that. I agree with you.
Rape in marriage has happened. All kinds of deviant behavior has happened in terms of sexual.
I think you can't make sexual violence about class at all. I think
a lot of pressure on women as wife, as girlfriends, as. You know, it's across the board.
No, I think I don't think we should get into making sexual violence about class, but factors of isolation in our urban lives, the earlier issues of neighborhood policing, ties of family, community breaking down. As we deal with urban life, these are the new realities we face. But can we at least reinforce existing laws that are there as we look at this debate, which is not at an end anytime soon? Thank you all very much, my guests, for joining me this evening. Let's just end this evening with a rare vignette. Today, 40 is just a number, says Sachin Tendulkar, and he celebrated his birthday today in, well, only naturally in a way, by playing cricket. He's currently